I can think of a thousand things to preach on. But I just thought about what y'all have. Now, when people start talking and gossiping, you can lose what you have and get what you want. But I'd rather have what you got than what I'd want. Yeah. Old black singer said, I lost what I had and got what I wanted. Brooke Bent, I've got that. And I thought about, I'm going to preach a message on it. I won't preach in a real mean church, though, because if I mentioned one of those singers, they'd pass out. But I never listen to much music. Hello, darling. It's been a long time. Four walls above me, I don't listen to much. I found my thrill on Calvary's Hill. Take your Bible tonight and go to the book of 2 Kings. I apologize when I preach. I do now have some problems. I apologize for it. But try to get the gist of the message. 2 Kings 2. Give me up another bottle of that water, son. Praise God. You lick on top of it? Oh, hell, that won't hurt nothing. I got that aging disease too. Let's stand together and go to 2 Kings chapter 2. Now, what I do now, I don't read as much as I used to. I try to cut out a whole lot of things, but I'm going to read some. How many knows the story of Elijah and Elisha? I have to read it all, looks like, Lord. I'll be up here on that. It came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went up with Elisha from Gilgal, cutting away the flesh. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth, as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel, to the house of God. And the sons of the prophets that were at Bethel came forth to Elijah and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? In other words, his fixed to go up to heaven in a whirlwind. He said, yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace. And Elijah said unto Elisha, here I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho, a city of palm trees. And he said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elijah and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he answered, yea, I know it. I wonder why they kept saying that. Hold ye your peace. We keep saying the Lord's a coming. And Elijah said to him, tarry, I pray thee here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan. And he said, as the Lord liveth, and thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they two went on. How can two walk together except they be agreed? And 50 men of the son of the prophet went and stood in the view afar off, and they two stood by Jordan. And Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together. Notice that word mantle. And smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. Every preacher has a mentor. Elijah was Elisha's mentor. Amen. It came to pass, and when they were gone over, that Elijah said to Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee. Before I be taken away from thee. And Elijah said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And if you study this out, you'll find that he performed twice as many miracles as Elijah did. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. It came to pass as they still went on and talk, behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horse of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind in the heaven. And Elisha saw it and cried, my father, the chariot of Israel, and the horsemen thereon. And he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and ripped them in two pieces. And he took up the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and went back and took him to the bank of Jordan. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over. And when the son of the prophets, boy, they're always out there saying something, which were to view at Jericho, this account meeting with sideline preachers, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elijah. Father, Lord, I pray you'd help me physically. I pray you'd help me spiritually. Pray you'd help me mentally tonight. God, let me remember the time. God, but let me try to preach what you'd have us to preach. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I want to say it's been such a wonderful day to be with you. If I have to leave tomorrow and go to heaven, it'll sure be a good place to go to heaven from. I can say that to you. Now, I want us to think about this tonight. If anybody needs to go to the restroom, don't fall in. Try to come back. But I want to preach on the mantle of Elijah. Now, first of all, us military men knows what a poncho is. We'd put them things on, and we'd stick our head out, cover up our head, and that poncho would cover us. Now, a mantle is a covering. Ephesians 4, verse 24, he said, put on the new man, and the new man, when you got saved, was Christ Jesus. He become your Lord, and he become your Savior, and your Redeemer, and your Comforter, and your Compassionate One, and your Calling One. He's a sent one that'll come back into the church. Would somebody shout amen? He's coming again. Amen. Number one, it's a mantle of supply. I'm not going to read a lot. Now you can go back and read this in 1 Kings 17:17. Now Elijah was being watched by a young preacher. Now there's a lot of young preachers in this church and young ladies that they've heard me preach since they're a little kid. Pee Wee Hayes told me one time, he said, they quoted you more in that camp meeting over at Camden Baptist Temple than did Charles Haddon Spurgeon. But he said, most of them don't want you to preach for them. Well. But I want to tell you something. You're meeting a guy with one of the best attitudes in the world. I only want to preach where God puts me. Well, do I have a witness in the house anywhere? Whoa, somebody say amen right there. Now, Elijah was a happy man. Elijah was a satisfied man. And he was down in 1 Kings 17 by the brook. Now, when you're by a brook, it's peaceful. When you're by a brook, it's comforting. When you're by a brook, you know you won't have to go to Kmart or Walmart and buy no water. Because you'll have some good, pure water. Now, Coca-Cola's good. Pepsi's not good. But Coke is good. But there's nothing like a drink of water. Oh, good, cold, clear, pure water. Now, there it was down by brook. We'll look at that mantle number one tonight. That it's a mantle that God supplies your every need. Now, while he's down there, he drunk all the water he could handle. All of a sudden, he hollered and said, send me a meal on wheels. Here come one of those dirty birds in, if you please, a raven. And he brought meat in the morning, meat in the afternoon. Hey, man, Hardee's wasn't around. McDonald's wasn't around. The Longhorn Steakhouse wasn't around. Come on now. But God was around. Why don't you say to yourself, God's around. God will give you water to drink. God will give you meat to eat. God will give you a house to live in. God will give you a car to drive. We don't serve a dead God. We're not serving Buddha. We're serving the one that got up on the third day. And the God we serve is alive. He's alive. was by a brook. Now, when you're by a brook, you're satisfied. When you're by a brook, you're being sanctified. When you're by a brook, you're being sustained. And while you're by a brook, 1 Corinthians, you're being steadfast, doing what God told you. Now, a young preacher cannot stand to sit down by the brook. I got to preach. No, you got to get by the brook and get a little training first. Now, before I went to Germany, I got 16 weeks training, 4 more weeks training, and some more training. And I had some guys said it was my mom and my daddy. They didn't look like it. Now, when you got to sit by a brook, mama, that ain't watching as the world turns. By the brook, you got your affection on the Lord Jesus. Now, the reason you can't put your affection on the Lord Jesus, you had never met the Lord Jesus. You had one of them little professions of faith. I didn't have no profession of faith. I got blood washed, born again, baptized in the Holy Ghost, linked with the blessed hope of the great God and our Savior, the Lord Jesus. I got something real. Now then, them brooks dried up. Amen. A brook will dry up. You'll come in here one day, and there won't be no water bubbling. Oh, come on. I've been there and done that. Huh? What do you got to do? You got to dig a little deeper in the storehouse of God's love. But in Elijah's case, now Elisha's watching him. You're looking at me tonight. Oh, you know I won't be around but a few more years. I'm going to leave you one day and go to heaven. A lot of people would love me to see me gone. One day I will. Huh? He said, now here's how God gets all that starch out of you. He said, now, Elijah, go down to the widow woman's house. What was he doing with Elijah? He was taking the pride out of him. He was taking the starch out of him. There ain't no big old man that wants to go to a widow woman's house and ask for food. But see, God makes you and God breaks you. God molds you. And before God gets done, you're going to look like Jesus. You're going to have a different attitude. That same chapter. He got up from the brook. Lord, I want to stay by the brook. I don't want to go to the widow's house. He got out of the widow woman's house, and he said, I sure am hungry. Been several days, hadn't had no meals on wheels. The butler didn't come by to bring me a big long, you know, but anyhow, I won't talk about that. He said, didn't bring me nothing about to eat. And he went down there, and he said, now, I want something to eat. She said, we just got a little meal left. How many of you older folks, many times you just had a little meal left. You young people don't know nothing about that. Because mommy has took care of y'all and daddy. Come on now, help me a little while. Don't look at me like I come in a load of punk and not born at night, not last night. And she said, I got a little bit of meal and 2 sticks to start the fire. That's all it'll take tonight to get a fire starting this journey. That meal is the Lord Jesus. Them 2 sticks is the cross. Woo! I wish somebody give me a witness tonight. Someone. And a little girl got lost one day. Police said, honey, said, I'll take you home if you'll tell me how to get there. She said, all I know, I live close to a church, and if I can ever see that cross in that church, I can find my way home. Honey, I'm not going home because I'm a Baptist. I'm going to heaven because of that meal and that cross. Would somebody shout amen? That's why you're here tonight. You're here because of the cross of Calvary, the Son of God. I can ever find that cross, I can find my way home. You better be careful. I may hurt myself. Now, don't preach me to death. I'm an old man. I'm used to being calm and collective and cool. Now, number two, not only is it a matter of supply, God will take care of your need. Philippians 4:19, every need. The little lady that stood up, don't know nothing about her, know what she needs. But I'll guarantee along to you that God will take care of your need. I don't care what you need. Now, I prayed for a car one time. Pretty car. I got it. It got more miles per gallon than any car I'd ever owned. It was towed by the wrecker every time I went anywhere. I got what I wanted, but I lost what I had. You'll get that? Sometimes God will give you what you want, but it's not what you need. Oh, come on and help me a little while. Amen. Number two, it was a mantle of sufficiency. Now, here was a man by the name of Ahab. Ahab is about like our politics in America today. Oh, come on, don't look at me like I come in a little. I mean, we're in the biggest mess America's ever known the last 15, 20 years. Come on. Huh? Ahab looked at the man of God and he said, "You're troubling Israel." But this man of God wasn't wearing his wife's underwear. He said about John the Baptist, "Did you go out to see a reed shaking in the wind? Or somebody wearing king clothes?" He said, "Well, no, man, he was out there eating locusts, biting their heads off. Had on camel's hair, turned around backwards. Said he looked like a bear. He was out there." Well, he didn't look like what preaching that pulpit, Jesus said, but that's a man of God. He came in the spirit of Elijah. You need a man with the power of God. Don't worry about what he looks like. Don't worry about how he's dressing. Worry about if he got God, the power of God. I'm going to tell you something, children. Y'all got something not many churches got, but you got to have the power of God. Can I say that again? You got to have the power of God. Anytime you put God outside, he's going to let you run the show. Ain't that right, Sister David? I wish I had her down here. Now, I think we ought to ordain this young girl here. She had to hit the pulpit. I said, "Under God," I said, "she's got her tonight." Huh? Huh? What's wrong? A woman can testify. She can't preach. But my God Almighty, we need some women that's alive, not dead. We need some of the power of God. Well, he said, "Now, Mr. King, with your little lacy breeches and your little hocus pocus wine, let's have a contest." He said, "We'll get us some bullocks. And we're going to set up an altar. You call on Baal. I'll give you from morning till midday." He set that altar up. And 450 prophets. Of Muslim prophets, if you please. Mohammed prophets. Don't look at me like that. Praise God. I'm an American. Amen. I'm a military man. I like them like Schwarzkopf. Amen. Mean and lean, a fat machine. We need some men again. Amen. You can say anything you want to about Larry Montgomery, but I'll tell you what, he is mean. He wasn't none of that outfit. They made it. Put him away a while, but he is still a man. Come on now. Well, hey, Mr. Rand, now I want to say this. if you're calling for fire, are you going to stand on the altar? Now, you know, when I'm a redneck preacher, but I'm smarter than if I think fire is going to fall to get right where it's going to fall. And, come on, help me a few minutes. Huh? I know you're going to get something burned if you stay on that altar. And then they got their knives out. Matter of fact, let me see if I got a good knife. Always carry me one. That's a sharp one. Good knife. They got their knives out and started cutting themselves, the lashes. Now, you know what? When anybody cuts themselves, you know what that is? Demonic power. I've traveled all over the world. Them demon worshipers, they get to cutting themselves and sucking blood out of a chicken neck. Voodoo worshiper. They don't do that. They do that too. They'll get out on the ground and they'll sliver around like a snake. You know what I am? I'm a blood wash, born again, saved, sealed, satisfied with a song. We're not voodoo worshipers. We're God Almighty worshipers. We're Holy Ghost worshipers. We're Jesus worshipers. So then Elijah sat over and said, "Hey, Ahab, why don't you tell them prophets to holler a little louder?" Said, "Your God might be on vacation. Kiss your wife. She looks sad." And he said, "He might be a little sick or something wrong with your God." Huh? I'd hate to know. I went out every day. My God, I'm out. Ain't that sick? Oh, I go in them countries. Wear a little hat on their head. I ain't got religion. I'm saved by the grace of God. We're blood washed. Why don't you tell yourself that I'm a blood washed Christian? Shout it out. I'm blood washed. Elijah went back over there, put everything in order. Amen. Said, "Bring me some water. 4 barrels. Now listen, it hadn't rained in 3 years and 6 months. The miracle of this thing was he knew God was going to send rain. Right on down. He knew, he believed his God wouldn't let him down. Boy, I'll tell you what, if I was young and I'd run outside and I'd go, "Wow! We serve a good God." So Elijah sets that altar back up. He said, "Set the stones in place, one for each tribe of the nation of Israel." He said, "Pour 4 barrels of water." I know what that is, 4 barrels of water. Amen. He prayed about a 62-word prayer. Come on, help me just a minute. Now, I'm preaching on God sufficient. What did he get? He got fire. It come down and licked up the water. Licked up the stone, licked up the dust. I mean, son, it was finger-licking good what he got. It just kept on licking. Huh? Red God, better than a Timex watch. They say they'll take a licking and give on a ticking. Red God, he didn't want a ticking. He wanted a licking. And the fire failed. Somebody said, the fire failed. Hey, man, licked up the stone, licked up the dust, licked up the water. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a risen Savior. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. So, amen. We see a man of sufficiency. The contest. Called a bell. Conclusion. God got fired. But now number 3, it wasn't only a mantle of supply, a mantle of sufficiency, but it was a mantle of security. Anybody got a sword? Man ought to have a sword around the house of God. We got a knife, but not a sword. Now, when he got done, I like a man that's got a lot of guts. He said, I'm not trying to be mean. I'm preaching the word. He took 450 prophets. Are y'all listening to me? He took his sword. He laid them down across there and whacked 450 heads off. Piled them up in the pile. I'm going to tell you, you know what I like about the devil? Nothing. You know what the devil's ever done for me? Nothing. All he's ever done is caused me to lose sleep. Amen. I stayed 35 years a pastor. There's always somebody. Huh? Got there, you know, anyhow. Huh? Now, he got what he asked for, but when he got it, he's afraid. Now, he got scared of a woman. And J. Harold Smith said, if a woman ever gets sad, you better run. Now, my mama's a woman. Her name wasn't Pete. Her name was May. My wife's a woman. But he said, now, Jezebel. Jezebel. Jezebel said, you done mess with my man. Stand by your man. You know what I mean, Vern? Now, there he was. And old Jezebel said, I'm going to tell you something. I'm gonna get you. Yeah. Yeah. And you're too. Hey, son, you can run good. Take off running down through there. Boy, he heard that. Boy, he started running. Oh, yeah, he started running. And he run until he was tired. I don't preach about 30 minutes anymore, so I'm almost down to the stopping point. And he hid under a juniper tree. But I want to say something. In your most discouraging time, God will be there. He was scared, but God came by and baked him a cake of grace. In your darkest hour, mamas and daddies, I love you. God will not let you down. I don't care if you're not even saved. Tonight, God's give you grace to get saved. I mean, in your darkest hour, when you're driving a car drunk at 100 miles an hour, God could have killed you. But God sent the marvelous grace to let you live. Where you wouldn't have to go to hell. God's a good God. He's a God of grace. He's a God of mercy. And then he is protected. But I want to come on down a little bit, down towards the end. It's a mantle that causes others to serve. I hope when I go to churches that I can call somebody who won't be a Christian. You ever been low? Well, one day I did. Who was that, Miss Gill? Dr. Bobby Leonard's. I don't know. I got back there in the back of the house, and I was squalling like you'd beat me with a whip. I was low. I mean, God was having a good time, but I was low. And Gail said, preacher. And when she said preacher, that means you better listen. She normally calls me worse things than that. Amen. She said, they're wanting you up there. I said, what for? I'm saying, I'm crying. I can't even see nothing. I went up there. I'm talking about a mantle called others, sir. That's the kind of mantle you want. And I went up there. And he said, I want you to pray for the food, but I believe you ought to preach a little while. I preached 5 minutes, 175 shouting, and I booked at least 25 meetings through that endeavor. I'm old. I got to have help, man. And there's a line of kids About like Cornbread, about like your pastor, there's lined. I call them young men. There's lined all the way to the back. They said, "Preacher Dalrymple, you come by daddy's when I got saved." Another one say, "Preacher Dalrymple, I was called to preach unto you." Boy, I forgot about this encouragement. God will send you a handful of hay, man, on purpose in your darkest hour. When you have no money, somebody will give you a little bit of money. When you have no car, God will give you a car. God always on time, every time. God cannot, Lord God, He cannot fail. God cannot fail. God never had fail. God can't fail. If I was young, I would preach. I'm old.
Huh?
Now, there he was. Elijah picked up that mantle. Now, he doesn't watch Elijah use her. He doesn't see the water parting. He had the mantle. Who's the youngest preacher in the house? Got any young preacher in the house? Come here, son. I don't know you. I won't embarrass you. I won't talk about you being flat-footed or nothing, okay? That's old preacher Dalrymple's. His man. I want y'all to think about this just a minute. I do not believe that Elisha took off running with that man. I believe, I read it to you a while ago. I believe he hesitated. It worked for mommy and daddy. It worked for the preacher. You think that mantle will work for me? That mantle represents Christ. Can I tell y'all, in thought of love in the world, I just come out of about a 3-month bout. The doctor told my wife, said, "He's fortunate to be alive." She thought I was dying when she brought me home. My whole tonsil had my air restricted. All kind of, they cut me all to pieces. Didn't look like I'd ever preach again. You know what I was concerned about? I wasn't even worried about going to heaven. I said, "I hope I can get better before I can preach again." My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all of folly, my sin, I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I loved him, Jesus, it is right now. Well, I'll love thee in life. I'm going to love thee in death. I'll praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath. And I'm going to say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Now, the way you get a man's mantle, you have to be like him. You just have to. Now, John the Baptist had the spirit of Elijah on him. Now, Elisha has now got the spirit of Elijah on him. Now he's got the mantle. The thing he's saying, what am I going to do with it? So he gets over there. And he comes down to Jordan. And he wiggles that mantle a little. I'm coming down then. You know what you'll say? I wonder if God will bless me like that. I know that girl's mommy and her daddy, his wife. They raised a big family. And I bet she's said it many a time. I wonder if God will take care of us like he did mother and daddy. I'm trying to make a point tonight. Don't you want to get a real good mantle? That mantle is Jesus. Well, say now, preacher, I was in one of them little soul-winning conferences. And I made a profession of faith. You must be drawn by the Holy Ghost. You must be birthed into God's family. Now then, here's a man said, I'm called to preach. Now he's got a mantle. What will he do with it? Well, he'll hesitate for a day or two. But he'll go to Jordan. And when nobody's looking, he'll take that mantle. You know what's going to happen? The water's going to roll back hither and thither. You're going to go over on dry ground. Why? God said, I'll do for you what I've done for all the previous. Well, see, I got a problem tonight. Oh, I'm sure what I'm preaching on. Thank you, sir. God bless you. You're a good mantle holder. I got a problem that I cannot solve. Now, there's a verse. I read it the other day. Is anything too hard for God? Now, teenagers, don't marry any Joe Blow. Huh? If you're going to get care of that mantle, you need a good man. Huh? Vice versa. And I want to ask you tonight as I close. What are you going to do with the mantle? I remember when I'd be in camp meetings as a young man. I thought, man, I wonder if they'll call on me to preach. I thank God they didn't. I got up and made a fool out of myself. And I'll just be honest with you. I'm more scared now preaching than I was when I was younger. But I didn't come to hurt nobody. I come to help you. You know some mother's mantle that you want to pick up? Now, I got one illustration. Here come Lester Waters with a drunkard in our town. He went out to the barn. A few of y'all can relate to this, to get him a drink of liquor. Now, where I come up, they didn't have Morgan David. They had it made at the still called White Light. Moonshine. Here he went to get him a drink of moonshine in the wintertime. Here comes his little boy, Charlie, walking in the snow. His daddy turned around and said, Charlie, what are you doing? Daddy, I'm walking in your footsteps. Everything they see you do or what they hear you say, our language has got terrible. And Lester Waters, that day made a turn very shortly, got saved, become a great preacher. Who's following your footsteps? Somebody. Now here's an old song. After I leave for worlds unknown, over the borderline, will I be missed by those I love? What will I leave behind? Leave behind, oh, leave behind. What will I leave behind? After I leave for worlds unknown, what will I leave behind? Will you leave behind a praying mantle? Will you leave behind a studying manual like this? Will you leave that behind? My daddy did. Will you leave behind a witnessing mantle? Will you leave behind a friendly mantle that you were friendly? Will you leave behind a good attitude? Are you like a boa constrictor ready to fight all the time? Will you leave behind a mantle of love? I got a father-in-law. I've never saw him with a bad attitude. Never. Never. I've never seen my wife get up in the morning mad. She gets up smiling. Now, I can't say that about my kids. I've seen them get up a little bit irritated. As I close tonight, preacher, are you going to leave behind a preaching mantle? Or was you a good mixer like Mr. Oast, I mean, in here, whatever his name is? Now, here's what I want to leave behind. I'd like tonight to leave behind that I promoted old-time religion where I went. Everywhere I've gone, been a cheerleader. I want to leave behind for my grandkids. Papa was a promoter of old-time religion. You know them old songs? I'm glad Jesus came, glory to his name. Oh, what a friend is he. He so freely gave his whole life to say, from bond of sin set free. You going to leave that behind? Or are you going to leave some of this contemporary? God. Huh? What kind of mantle? I love you. Are you going to leave behind? Good attitude, praying, preaching, loving, forgiveness. What are you going to leave behind? Father,